then, of course, there is Jeff Nuttall and Olivia Soane. And yes, our artistic directors, who unfortunately succumbed to COVID, they are still quarantining in Mount Pleasant, and we miss them severely, but we're thinking of them every single moment of the day, practically. So it was Jeff that called me a few months ago and said, you know, I always want to get everybody on stage for the final concert, and I have this idea of the Marriage of Figaro Overture. Do you think you could arrange that for whoever's left? And I said, sure, Jeff, who could that be? Or who would that, what instruments might they be? So here we are, and here is our personnel. We have Nina Lee and Chris Graves on cello. The man who is almost as tall as his instrument, Tony Monzo. One-of-a-kind violist, Ruth Gibson. James Austin Smith. And then we have our wonderful violin section. We have Cindy Simonin from the Castilian Quartet. We have Abigail Hong from the Ladle Festival Orchestra. We have Daniel Roberts, also from the Castilian String Quartet. And we have Sophia Burditz from the Spoleto Festival. Last but not least is our timpani player, Enon Barnaton. So, what's quite extraordinary about this 4-minute overture is that Mozart had completed a 3.5-hour opera, one of his greatest successes in his career as a composer, an opera that is still in the top 5 of the most performed operas around the world today. It's quite amazing. So the night before, he pens an overture that is known around the world, and you know it by the first 5 notes. And the most extraordinary thing about the overture is that none of the music in the orchestra, in the overture, is in the opera at all. And where did he come up with all this new music? Wouldn't he be exhausted after writing a huge piece like The Marriage of Figaro? Apparently not. So it's what I like to call a masterpiece in miniature. And so here it is for the kitchen sink. Thank you.
Amazingly, Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach lived for all but four of the years of Mozart's life. So he had a lifetime that spanned two huge pillars of the sort of classical music canon, the Baroque era and the classical era, and Carl Philipp Emanuel Bach was the guy navigating those waters, among others, of course. And so you hear in his music a kind of searching for something, searching maybe for the future. And that is especially evident in the first movement of this sonata, where it's my line is looking for something in the same way that my colleagues on the cello and in the left hand of the harpsichord are also looking. And sometimes we're looking in the same place, and sometimes we're looking in very different places all at the same time. It's a strange journey, which eventually ends somewhere with some kind of cadence, some kind of understanding that maybe we found something. And indeed, in the second movement is a bit more straightforward. Nice, lovely, gallant, he finds his way through this beautiful allegro. And he concludes the sonata with another version of the searching, a theme in variations. He takes a theme, and then he finds three different ways to say that theme after, right? So I would say in this piece, if when we're listening, we're often listening for the what, or maybe the how. In this piece, it's a little bit more like the where and the why. And so I'd invite you all, we're gonna give you this material as best we can. And I'd invite you all to, as we always do when we're listening, search for the answers to those questions. It's been such a pleasure to be here with all of you the last couple weeks, and we are going to miss you. Please join me in welcoming to the stage the wonderful Nina Lee and Petra Muzikic.
Too late.
slide.
Thank you. Harpsichord, that's some other guy. I get this a lot. Great to be here. I'm Petra Bujevich. It is, as Todd said, it's always bittersweet at the end of our stint here. This is a place we all love, and that love comes from many places, first and foremost from music, from friendships, from all of you, and it's always led by our dear Jeff, so another applause. For final piece on this year's festival is perhaps an odd choice. It's a Stravinsky Rite of Spring, which was originally a ballet for orchestra, and there was this version of piano duet that actually Stravinsky himself did for two different reasons. He played it with Debussy, but also obviously at that time, if you wanted to rehearse, there was no CD, there was no radio. I mean, there was radio a little bit, I suppose. But the only way to make music to play it, so there had to be a version, something that they could use in rehearsals. But this arrangement of Galatea is actually quite masterfully done, and the piece itself premiered on May 29, 1913 in Paris, and it's one of these things like the Woodstock Festival. there, as many people who were there, and as many as who claimed to have been there, because it was a very famous debacle, because the work had probably in equal parts proponents and opponents, and there was literally a cat fight in the audience. The fight was so loud that at some point the choreographer, Vaslav Nijinsky, had to run to the wings to count to the dancers because they could not hear the orchestra. Soon enough, you will hear how loud this music is, so that will, you know, think of that, how loud the fighting had to have been. I don't encourage you to fight. Friendly people. But a bit of background about the piece. The piece was commissioned by Sergei Diaghilev, who was an impresario, a Russian impresario who lived in Paris. That time in Paris, probably the most interesting interdisciplinary collaboration in the arts of any time ever. There was this confluence of events that led people to be there. Some of it had to do with American wealth, some of it had to do with the Industrial Revolution, the World Expos in Paris, the Russian Revolution, and there were all these artists, musicians, visual artists, theater artists, and dancers who ended up in Paris. So there were these amazing collaborations between Picasso and Cocteau and Satie and Stravinsky and Diaghilev and Nijinsky. So it was an incredibly creative time, and the work itself is a pagan story, a Russian pagan story about a young woman who is chosen to be sacrificed, and she dances herself to death. Enon and I may fall down from fierce counting towards the end. So there may be a reenactment of that. But as a result, this is the time where perhaps the idea of art being not only about beauty, but being about whole life experience and the truth, inspired Nijinsky to choreograph this piece in a very brutal way and not stylized at all, this time where, of course, in Paris and Russia, the ballet tradition was very strong, and ballet, classical ballet, is so much about stylized movement. So when these dancers came on stage and put their flat foot on the stage and stomped, this was really a shock. So the scandal and the debacle was really more about the dance. So there's plenty of music to shock as well. So it became this kind of legendary premiere, and in so many ways, this Rite of Spring in 1913 shaped the music of the 20th century. So it's in two parts. This will give you some guidance on the titles of the part. Those of you who are remote control can try to change it and watch some Netflix. But anyway, so Stravinsky, Rite of Spring, Enon Barnatan, and I are happy to bring it to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.